Hello everyone, so today we're here with Dr. Felipe de Souza, and we are at the Lennar Medical Center here in Miami, Florida, and we're going to go ahead and start this A Day in the Life of an Interventional Radiologist.
Sounds good.
All right. So Dr. de Souza, can you please tell us about your background, your current experience, and your training experience as well?
Okay, so my background, I'm from Brazil, so I did my med school in Brazil, University of São Paulo. I did radiology residence there. Then my background is a little bit different from a little bit of the other IRs because I initially did like a MSK radiology fellowship, and during the MSK radiology fellowship, I did a lot of procedures, like but much more like MSK procedures, like spine, biopsies, injections, and then I got interested in interventional radiology. Then I started working a little bit, and at some point I decided to do a real interventional radiology fellowship. That's when I did the fellowship here at University of Miami. I did the IR fellowship here, and after I completed my IR fellowship, I was hired as an attending here in both MSK and interventional radiology department. So this is pretty much like a very short version of my background, but right now I work here, University of Miami, we cover Jackson, UM, all the sites, doing procedures, all the different procedures that we do here regarding interventional radiology.
Thank you very much. So I know you said you work in Miami. So what makes practicing IR in Miami so unique?
I think what's unique is our department. You know, I think whenever I interview a candidate or a fellow, I say that what I like a lot in the job is that we have like four different jobs in one job. Now we have like Jackson Memorial Hospital, that's kind of like a big county hospital, like big trauma center, so it's kind of like one patient population. We do a lot of trauma cases, big transplant center, so a lot of transplant complications, so it's very interesting case log. Then you move to Lennar, it's more like a private practice kind of setup, so we have like more bread and butter cases, although I do all my more complex MSK kyphoplasties here. I try to do here Lennar because workflow for me is better. And then you have Sylvester Cancer Center, that's a big cancer center, so a lot of like interventional oncology procedures like Y90, ablation, stays, biopsies, we do a lot of stuff there, this kind of like interventional oncology. And also have like the UM hospital, that's kind of like the backup place for the Sylvester, so a lot of like cancer related complications, more like a lot of sick patients, like end of life care, all this stuff. So that's what I think the unique part of the job, that it's not boring, not every day in the same place, doing the same kind of procedures, dealing the same people. That's what I think, that's what I love the job, because it's not, the routine is kind of different every day, and that makes it more challenging.
I see. Earlier you told us that you initially did an MSK fellowship and then got some exposure to IR. So what drew you to MSK and what drew you to kind of further that training into IR?
When I was in med school, I liked a lot of orthopedics. I almost applied for orthopedics, but I didn't like a lot of like those kind of chronic pain patients that have to deal with. And what I tell a lot of med students that if you want to do some specialty, like you want to like the bread and butter of your specialty. You don't want to only like, oh, I'm going to be a CT surgeon, but I only like to do heart transplant. No, it's not gonna happen like that. So you need to like the bread and butter, and that's why I chose radiology. And at this point, because I like it a lot of MSK orthopedics, I went more to MSK because you still have like the diagnostic, like sports medicine. That's something that I still like. Still focus a lot on my practice. Even IR, I do a lot of like joint embolization, other stuff. But in MSK radiology, we still do a lot of procedures. But those procedures that I was doing as a radiologist was not enough for me to be happy, to feel accomplished. That's why, at some point, doing only MSK radiology was not enough for me.
So what conditions or pathologies do you most often see in your MSK patients?
In my MSK patients, we see a lot of like pain also, knee arthritis. So I became like a good center for genicular artery embolization or ablation. Like I have a patient today, but we do embolization ablation on a weekly basis. I like a lot the spine procedures. So we do kyphoplasty, kyphoablations, and also I like to treat tumors a lot. So that's in the MSK tumors. So we have the chance to cure patients a lot of times, so either for benign tumors like osteosarcoma, and even for malignant tumors, if the patient's like a single tumor, we can ablate, cement, everything. So that's what I like a lot to do, and that's my main focus. But so there's no only interventional oncology in MSK. We do a lot of like oncology patients, like for bone metastasis, primary tumor, bone tumors, or soft tissue tumors. We are a big center for desmoid tumors, so we treat a lot of those patients. But also for now, we are growing in kind of like the degenerative side, so osteoarthritis, treating patients with osteoarthritis that are not good candidates for arthroplasties, stuff like that. I think there's a big room for improvement, and we're growing a lot on that aspect.
Well, thank you for that answer. So how do you decide when an MSK IR procedure is more appropriate than like a surgical or conservative type of management?
I think we have like a, that's fundamental in medicine today, have like a multidisciplinary approach for the patients, no? So it's not only my decision, but of course I explain to the patient, usually we're not like a procedure person, no? We are a clinic. That's important to understand that IR is a clinician. So we see patients in the office, we discuss the patient, we evaluate the patient, and also I communicate with the doctors that are referring the patients to me and say, hey, I think this patient would be a good candidate for me to start treating. If it doesn't help, you can go to another kind of like approach, but it's also always a multidisciplinary approach, and I discuss all the time with like either the orthopedic oncology or the joint person or the spine person, and we do a discussion. So it's never only my decision, but we are making a decision in combination.
So are there any recent innovations or devices within MSK interventional radiology that has significantly impacted your practice?
I think now we are being more aggressive or more involved, let's say like that, in treating metastatic bone disease. So we are moving to more like percutaneous fixation as well. So not like just biopsying. We are treating the lesions, we are fixing, we are stabilizing areas that are concerned for fractures. This is something that we have been working on that a lot. The other area that I think is growing is like the, what they call it in MSK word, the inflammatory embolization. Also, this has started like maybe in Japan, like some years ago, about just like they're doing like knee embolization, so the genicular artery embolization. That's a established procedure now, but I think has been a lot of studies and a lot of like ideas of not only keep the embolization for the knee, but we can do embolization for frozen shoulder, for plantar fasciitis, for epicondylitis. So this is something that we can still have like a lot of room to study, to grow, and to help patients. And on top of that, of course, all the new kind of treatment, percutaneous treatment for bone metastasis, that's something that has been growing a lot.
Along the same lines, what's one of the most challenging and rewarding cases that you've handled recently?
Recently, I think I had like a patient that was had a big, but I don't remember now. The patient was actually, I treated the patient multiple times for like the hip, I ablated the hip, I ablated the acetabulum, but at some point he presented like a mess in situ, the situ vertebral body, and he was metastatic to the liver, everything, so it was not much to do, but that lesion was a big soft tissue component and was growing fast, and at some point that lesion wasn't going to grow and was compressed the spine, the situ, so it would be a disaster, so was not much like surgical option because the patient was very sick. So I took the chance and I did a situ kyphoplasty, which was not very comfortable. I didn't understand the guidance, of course, but it was good because I could like knock out the lesion and the patient lived for more like 2 years after that. So he, and it was a great case, I think. That was really like, if I remember, the most challenging case that I did recently and very rewarding. But we do a lot of cases, you know, it's interesting setup, like a lot of trauma that it's interesting to work on that. So a lot of things.
You had said that you know, it's very rewarding. So what are some of the most rewarding aspects of being an interventional radiologist?
I think a lot of times, if you want a recognition of the patient, don't do interventional radiology, okay? Because a lot of times you do the job, but you don't get the recognition. But we still have a lot of, it's rewarding when you see a patient in the clinic that you treated the patient, they go to the oncologist, they go to the surgeon, but they come back to you and say, hey, I want your opinion, whatever you tell me to do, I trust you, I want to do whatever you say because whatever you did with me was great and I'm here because of you. So I think when the patient puts you as part of the team that take care of them, that's amazing. And that's what the goal. You just don't want to be like the guy that does the procedure for the doctor. No, you want to be the person that does the procedure for the patient. And that's when it becomes rewarding. When the patient comes to you and they see you as their doctor and they trust you and they put their life on your hands, that's amazing. So that's what's rewarding, interventional radiology. That's not easy. A lot of times it's better not happen, but that's the goal.
I see. And another question that we have for you is, what are some, you do work now at an academic institution, so you're training a lot of residents and such. So what are some important qualities that makes a good interventional radiologist?
I think, first of all, is personality-wise, you need to learn to work with attendings, with techs, with nurses. Like, in my experience, I learn a lot from techs and nurses, and you need to be humble, not think like because you are a doctor or something like that, you're better than anybody else. No, maybe you have like better opportunities, but you're not smarter than anybody else. But to be humble, try to learn from everybody around you. For sure, you're gonna learn a lot from techs, from nurses, from other fellows. And of course, you need to have a good background in radiology. I think it's very important doing your training before you come to IR. Have a great background of radiology. That's what makes us better than other people when we do like image-guided procedure, because we know what we're doing. We know what to see, we know what we are need to take care about, we know what we need to avoid. So that's fundamental to be a great radiologist, then become a great interventional radiologist. And I think those are the main things in the beginning, of course. After that, try to do as much case as possible, understand the clinical scenario. You're a clinician, so you need to have a great clinical background, understand the disease, understand the pathology to treat the patient in an appropriate way.
Well, thank you for your answer. And what are some of the biggest challenges that you face either clinically, emotionally, or even like systematically wise as an interventional radiologist?
I think workload has been, it's hard, no, because if you think about a surgeon, and sometimes they do three, four, five cases a day, maybe sometimes one big surgery. So they're dealing with one surgery, they're seeing one patient, they need to know that, the history of one patient, they need to know the complications, like the labs for one patient. Sometimes you do like 18, 20 patients a day. So you need to know the history, the labs, the history, the complications, the plan for 18 patients. So that makes it a little bit harder. You have to consent 8 patients a day, you have to put 18 AGPs, 18 reports. So it's different. It's a different workflow. Although some cases are very fast, like sometimes a biopsy can take like in 5 minutes, but that 5 minutes is the easiest part of it after a day about that patient. You have to know what you're doing, understand, study the patient. So I think that's the most challenging thing about interventional radiology, that we are still kind of like in a surgery kind of specialty. I don't think it's anything related to the surgeon because it's totally different workflow. So if you think about, oh, I like surgery, but I'm going to do IR. No, it's a different life. It's a different workflow, different volume. But I think that's the most challenging thing right now for us is be on top of every patient, even with the high volume.
And many of your colleagues would describe interventional radiology as probably one of the best specialties in medicine. What is your sales pitch as why IR is the best field in medicine?
I totally agree. I think right now, technology, imaging advancements, everything, making interventional radiology even bigger. Like a lot of things that you would never think would be treated as interventional radiology has been treated right now. So interventional oncology right now, like I'm gonna give a quick example. Like there's a collision study that was just like released last year or early this year, comparing like ablation versus surgery, metastatic colon cancer, up to 10 lesions in the liver. So before we say, oh, the patient has one lesion in the liver, let's ablate. No, there's a study now, big study, the randomized, published already. If you're up to 10 lesions in the liver, you can ablate, and there's actually better outcome than surgery when you compare. So we are moving to much better approach with the technology, with imaging calibration, confirmation, for example, for ablation or for Y90, segmentomy, something like that. So I think our area of scope of work has been growing a lot, and the technology is on our side, and I think it's just going to get bigger and bigger, especially in oncology and palliative care.
Put the probe, which is this. This is what gives the radio frequency. Put it through, and then you start ablating.
We need a little lidocaine when we start. We have a blade here, maybe a little nick. We'll use this and a marker to help us mark our location. But other than that, yeah, don't need to make it. Local anesthesia. I remade the mix.
Okay.
Yep. Set for a 2.5 minute ablation at 60 degrees Celsius, or sorry, 2 minute 45 seconds ablation. The machine itself is measuring both the power and the impedance, as well as the temperature. So there's like that line there is the impedance. So you don't want it to go above that. The machine will shut off if there's too much impedance. Usually it's because, like Manny was saying, it's too close to the bone. So you're usually just readjusting your needle slightly. You're able to get over that if you did get that impedance alert. Right now it looks like we're doing okay. We're about 1:40 in. All the needles at the top second one to the left there, it tells you the temperature. They're all around the goal temperature, 60 degrees right now. All of our lines there are staying below the top line. So everything's looking good right now.